trying to get like my recorder straight on here. All this technology is like somewhat confusing at different times. Like I just want can like be audibly heard like with your ears and stuff.
And great eyes.
Cool. So like you can hear me, I can hear you. It's like connected.
Yep.
All right. Well, folks, we just want to welcome our special guest here today. You know what I'm saying? He's coming to us from like the country of Europe or something like that. He's like in like the Western Eastern part. I'm not sure exactly. And we're very happy to have him here today. And I'd like to make welcome Mr. Dan Summers. So thank you, Mr. Summers, for being with us here today.
Yes, it's the winter of our discontent over here. And you can call me Summers, all kinds of good.
Well, I appreciate that very much. I just like start out, you know, with prayer, if that's okay. Just like say, Holy Mother Lakshmi, like would ask for the consideration of your blessing on this interview to be for the highest good of all living beings. And we appreciate this opportunity very much. And it's really an honor for me to be speaking with one of my heroes on like the physics of bliss, like from, you know what I'm saying? He's like, you know, some kind of like electrical engineer or something like that by trade. But like, you know, in definition of that quantization, like preludes the concept of what we're going to be extrapolating on here today. So we just want to make that known for the people that's not familiar with his background, you know what I'm saying? But he's a very smart fellow, very articulative. And we just want to make sure that everybody knows who is in the room right now with us. So thank you very much again for being with us, Mr. Summers.
Yeah, thank you. And if anybody wants to follow some of the original pictures we prepared for today's conversation are at fractalfield.com/implosion sound. If they want to follow along, and we'll show some graphics, etc. And we're going to start with a little bit of science. Is that right?
That'd be beautiful. That'd be beautiful. I just want to like, you know, make as much room as I can possibly do. So like we can steer the star together. You know what I'm saying? You're a science man. And like, you know, we're just going to follow your lead. So thank you very much for guiding us through this process. You know what I'm saying?
Well, and your background is really musical. You have your following has a lot to do with people who are interested in music and music and healing and music and bliss, that kind of thing, right? That's where we start.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah. We try to bliss out with the music and the harmonics and all that kind of stuff. Try to find out a little bit about the Planck ratios and all this complosive expressive type of thing that you know so much about.
Right, right. So, you know, I thought, you know, we're going to go into some esoteric stuff, but let's just start with a very basic, simple wave science. That was the idea here. So I have just a couple of visuals prepared here. I'm going to click on share my screen. Excellent. And then I'm going to go to fractalfield.com/implosion sound. That's where we are. Are you seeing my picture here?
Yeah, I see a very handsome fellow on the screen right now.
And so this is the graphic. So basically how we started, if you imagine Einstein saying, he would know what the unified field was if he understood infinite compression. That's practically a quote from Einstein. Infinite non-destructive compression was what he missed when understanding the unified field and the cause of gravity, for example. And that's actually the clue to not just the cause of why things fall to the ground, but why anything gets centripetal and therefore self-organizing and healing. And so to find out what that is, we did something incredibly simple. First of all, as musicians, we discovered what the musical key signature of the universe is.
Is that like F sharp?
It's related, actually. It comes in there. The musical key signature of the universe is related to F, and we'll see that in a minute. But in terms of physics, it's very, very simple, and nobody disagrees. The musical key signature of the universe is called Planck, the Planck length of time. In other words, every wave that physics has ever measured is a multiple, divides evenly into the wavelength of Planck length in time, 1.61 times 10 to the minus 33 centimeters, and there's a corresponding unit of time. So that is the dimensioning of the quantum foam, and that literally is what's meant by quantized, is everything's quantized into Planck. Everything divides evenly in Planck, and if it doesn't fit in Planck, it doesn't fit in the universe. So
well, that's pretty easy to understand, I'd say. That's a good place to start.
That is clearly the place to start. The second thing, we wanted to know what Einstein's dilemma was, which was non-destructive compression. That he knew that if he discovered non-destructive compression, he'd have the unified field and the cause of gravity. And basically, if electric fields are perfectly compressed, infinitely compressed, we now know that's what they call fractal. In fact, in mathematics, the most important definition of fractality is perfect compression. Well, so then we need to think of what a fractal field is, and you can think fractalfield.com while you're at it. So we knew intuitively, of course, that that was related to golden ratio, but we did more. We proved it. So here's on top, we did a a mathematical emulation. We showed that if you took an infinite number of waves and you put them in octave cascades, all of your music for all your guitars is based on octaves, right? But octave cascades, you add and multiply those waves and cause heterodyning, constructive and destructive interference. With octaves, you get maximum destructive interference, actually. But at golden ratio, 1.618, you get the maximum residual, the maximum remaining inertia when the waves heterodyne infinitely, add and multiply, recursively heterodyne. And so golden ratio is the solution to maximum constructive interference. So we did that with computer emulation on top. And then we published our physics paper here, and you don't need to go into all the physics, which explains how that perfect fractality based on golden ratio is the cause of gravity, because it's implosive charge compression. And here is where we started with the geometry of hydrogen. I took golden ratio times Planck, and I proved that was three of the radii of hydrogen. We published. And what we did, we took something called the Navier-Stokes waves equations, and we proved that if you interfere waves in golden ratio on a line, you get maximum constructive interference and least destructive interference. And then we showed that if you stellate a dodecahedron, which now we know is how hydrogen is built, that same line is in every axis of symmetry of the pentadodecahedron-cosine-infinite fractal we call our star mother kit. So we proved that that was the perfection of compression, and therefore it's called conjugation of phases, adding multiply to conjugate. And so we not only did I prove that Planck length times golden ratio equals three radii of hydrogen, but we proved that that's how that fractality permits hydrogen to make gravity. So that's the background here that we said, oh, we've discovered perfect non-destructive compression. Now, where we go with this later in the conversation is you take that harmonic series, and here you can see you take Planck length times golden ratio powers and get three radii of hydrogen, ADP, ATP, the most important molecule in the cell. You get the only two frequencies of photosynthesis. You get the definition of sacred dimension, the British foot. You get the Schumann harmonics, the brainwave harmonics for bliss, the audio harmonics for making best bliss, now flameandmind.com. Mm. You get the LF HRV component, the Mayer wave, 0.1 hertz, most important frequency in the blood. You get the Venus year, the galactic year, the precessional year, and the Earth year, and the solar year. So all of those the intervals are defined precisely golden ratio times Planck. And so where those waves implode, we call that the origin of biologic negentropy, and that's the title of my book. So, little background, we just did the science in 2 minutes. Was that fun?
That was very fun. I'm not sure if you got like some kind of like digital fan blowing, but like right now, I'm like, my mind is like blown and it's right, like real. And I'm not going to pretend it, like I'm going to be able to understand this, but I'm going to go back and I'm going to review it. You know what I'm saying? I'm going to study it like I was in school, because I feel like I'm in school with Dan Summers right now. So thank you for that, like expository, like introduction to our conversation. I appreciate that very much.
And see how cool that is, because now I take golden ratio times Planck and I get the Schumann harmonics. I get the brainwave harmonics that make bliss. I get the sacrocranial harmonics of the spine liquid pump that make Kundalini go, alpha, beta, and brainwaves. I get all the important frequencies, including what we put in plasma to make healing and what we put in sound to make bliss. We make implosion. And that's the only way out of chaos, called origin of biologic negentropy. And you can see I'm excited about it because it's musical. It's just for you.
I love that. And so like Einstein, he was a very smart fellow, you know what I'm saying? But you can like stand on his shoulders to like help him, give him like a little lift, like with when it comes to like really discovering like what gravity was, which maybe was something he had a problem with.
Well, I think he did have a, I mean, you know, we don't mean to insult anybody, but if you don't know why an object falls to the ground, you also don't know why anything is centripetal, and therefore you have this dumb idea that the universe is condemned to chaos, instead of knowing there is a path out of chaos called the origin of negentropy, and it's that line of frequencies.
That is fantastic. Like I said, like you might have like a digital wind blowing, because my mind is blown right now. You know what I'm saying? I'd like to talk just briefly about the Uluru prophecy. You know what I'm saying? Have you heard of that?
Oh, absolutely. Sure. Yes, yes.
Mm-hmm. Cool. Yeah. So for those who don't know, it's like this Pleiadian magic box. It's going to turn on like on the solstice with the conjunctions and stuff like that. It's going to like activate the song lines and stuff like that, you know, across the dreaming and all that kind of stuff. So maybe there's some sort of like, you know, embeddable wave compression that involves like recursive braiding of the DNA and fractality that's going to go along with that activation. Would you like to speak a little bit about that?
Sure. In fact, we're planning a meditation for December 21 for our global plasma sites, the Therify.net global net plasma healing. And it's tuned to the Uluru prophecy, actually. Mm. And the website with that story is fractalfield.com/solstice global meditation. Mm-hmm. And on that website, here's the picture. Let's see, did I put my screen on here? Wait one second. Share screen.
Very exciting. Very exciting. It's a global party for meditation, the healing, the bliss.
Exactly. And we want to try to explain the science a little bit. So do you see a square, and a cube in front of you there? That
yeah,
picture?
I see that like Caduceus, like Althoffy.
Exactly. Yeah. That's exactly what it is. It's Caduceus. Exactly. Oh. Well, so if see, we're trying to suggest here that some of the science behind the metaphor with the Pleiadians, who are apparently communicating with the Aboriginal elders, called the Pleiadian cube. If you're a scientist and you're trying to get lasers to phase conjugate, which is the first place in physics, negentropy, self-organization, and time reversal was ever measured, what you need to do is arrange those lasers to make a perfect square, a perfect cube, actually. And the physics of why is because the opposing beams need to get lined up precisely so the pine cones kiss noses.
Oh, I love that part. I love that.
And the point is, if you get those lasers lined up with angstrom level accuracy, then when they converge, instead of destructive, they make constructive interference. And that's the beginning of self-organization. Now, if you got a planet that's having trouble holding itself together as the solstice and equinox, which are called phase conjugate moments, you know why Agnihotra uses precise sunrise and sunset. It's because at those right angles, phase conjugation is possible. And that embeds something called longitudinal electromagnetics. It's the long wave, it's a compressional wave, the longitudinal component of electromagnetics. And that's the physics of song lines and healing and
like
action at a distance and lucid dreaming and astral projection. All the fun stuff is based on longitudinal coherence. And what happens is, as the waves converge in a perfect, as they say, Pleiadian crystal cube, they implode towards center, and the inertia that was called transverse entering is translated in vorticity down the spiral on the cone and emerges out the center of that toothpaste tube at exactly Planck distance. And the inertia is translated from transverse to longitudinal compressional at that point. And longitudinal waves, they go faster than light, they can pass through almost anything, and they do action at a distance, and they're very cool. And if you embed in that, that's what the Egyptians called the Ba from the Ka, what Gurdjieff called the Kesjan body. And that's actually your lucid dreaming body. And that's the field effect that you communicate with ancestors, so much so that we know that when we do that with Therify.net, we make plasma do that, we've proven that you trigger lucid dreaming. So the reason they call them dreaming track song lines is, in fact, that along these lines, you get that nodal coherence, that interferometry. In fact, if we look here at our pictures of how the Earth grid is dodecaecosa, what we learned is that the reason that you need all the sacred sites on these songline dreaming tracks, where's our lovely pictures of the Earth grid in here, that the Earth grid dreaming track songlines, maybe I have the pictures more, are at dodecaecosa nodes. Here they are. This is my Australian Aboriginal graphics. Okay, so here, this is the original magnetic map of the area around Central Australia. And you see what they call song lines, if you map magnetically, are these white lines which have increasing magnetic flux density. And these correspond in the big picture to a dodecaecosa, the dreaming track song line. And so you see these Aboriginals sitting at the nodes, and their eyes are closed, and they're projecting themselves along this grid, this song line. And they're coherently interacting with the nodes at a distance, and they're getting leveraged the same way shaman steers a tornado, by this longitudinal EMF coherence. So basically, the reason is that these longitudinal waves, when they cross again at a distance perpendicularly, the longitudinal component is translated again back up that cone into the transverse EMF. Just the reason why the tsunami wave goes under a boat, you don't know it's past you, but when it hits the shore, it goes up the cone, becomes transverse at then, and then it'll kill you. So that's the reason you can store heat at a distance and do action at a distance That's what Einstein didn't understand. He called action at a distance spooky because he didn't understand these longitudinal waves. This is what gives you leverage on the wave nodes at a distance, is that longitudinal coherence. So, of course, when your aura, by implosive compression, gets that projectivity in the longitudinal, what bliss enables, then you can lucid dream and take memory through death. That's the ba from the ka.
I have two questions at this point. One is, like, why are you not famous like I am? And, like, two is, like, what do you say to people when they're like, you are just making all this up?
Well, you know, when we first discovered how phase conjugation makes longitudinal coherence, we marketed Therify.net, which is now commercially successful in 25 countries.
I heard of that. There's like one in Nashville, I think.
That's right. The Therify. It's basically a beautiful plasma system. Let me see here.
And you can like get in there and it'll like fix you up real good, because then pine cones kiss. And that's like a very intimate, romantical kind of like thing for bliss conjugation.
It true. And actually, 30% of people who get in there report a sharpening of vision, actually. And many women, particularly, who get in that field here. Can you see the picture? This is a picture of the Therify right here. So these plasma tubes, were firing them at a megahertz frequency, which is tuned to my equation. And then we modulate the low frequency component by my equation by about 15 harmonics of ELF infrasound, and we create perfect broad spectral pine cones kissing noses. And from this Tesla coil here, bottom right, we radiate the magnetic harmonic cascade of pain reduction. So at about 500,000 volts through a bifilar Tesla coil, we energize these plasma tubes. And when Priory did this in France, he healed thousands of cancers, but he didn't understand phase conjugation. He didn't know how to use a pair and didn't know how to tune it after you plan. So we perfected it, and it's been functional around the world. Well, recently,
nice.
And
you
can see incredible results reports and the blog and the stories and the testimonials at Therify.net. Point is, so Maya, our wonderful partner in Athens and Paris, just sent a detailed report of how this experience triggered dramatic lucid dreaming and telepathy. And this is not the only report. So now we know what the Aboriginals meant by the dreaming track songline. They meant they propagated a coherent longitudinal EMF body, literally the part of your body that becomes potentially immortal because it's distributable. It can be shared in perfect fractal distribution. But that inertia, the longitudinal grid, only bounces in and out and becomes available where these magnetic lines in the dodecahedral cross on the Earth grid, where Bruce Cathy measured radioactivity, was critical mass was dramatically reduced, and the place where you can measure the physics of telepathy and that kind of thing. So, and every cathedral and labyrinth and song line and perfect place to dream and to get born and get die, they all lie on these nodes because that's where the DNA radio works.
Now, can I like get one of those for like my house?
Sure.
Oh, that's very exciting, because I think that'd be like a great place to like record music, you know what I'm saying, with the pine cones kissing and all that stuff. You know, then you wouldn't have to worry too much about like the subliminals, because it'd all be like coherent, and like your DNA braiding would be like exceptionally like embeddable, I suppose. And that reminds me, actually, like I remember I read something about you being friends with this guy. I read his book called The Music of Time. His name was Preston Nichols. You remember him?
Yes, I knew Preston quite well, actually.
Yeah, he told a lot of stories. It was like quite mind-blowing, you know what I'm saying? And one of the things that he was talking about was like, you know, his pioneering efforts with like subliminal messages and all that kind of stuff with the iron oxide from the tape and the analog recording machines, you know what I'm saying? Is there anything you'd like to say about, you know, like his work and in conjunction with like the Montauk
Well, that's an appropriate
like
question.
And how that goes off.
Preston and I lectured together at many international psychotronics conferences. Mm-hmm. He was known in his relationship with Montauk for the development of what he called the Deca-Delta antenna, which is effectively an octahedron antenna, which we now know was radio frequency phase conjugator. In other words, implosive RF. And that led him to some of what the experience at Montauk was about. Now, remember, the Native Americans were doing a form of time travel at Montauk long before Johnny von Neumann and the others got in trouble there, because it was a node on the longitudinal grid, and that introduces the actual physics of what's called a portal. And unfortunately, the Montauk people did not actually know the physics of what a portal is. They had ideas and they were close. For example, when they made the film Stargate using the letters of the letters of the Ophanimanokian alphabet to make the hypercube plasma implosion portal, and then Jodie Foster traveled in a dodecahedron, for example, in contest. Awesome. Well, there were metaphors there which were introductory to the actual physics, but the actual physics is more elegant and actually more simple. If you take what we now know by, we can demonstrate with verified plasma, that if you center yourself well, you can plasma project. The physics of lucid dreaming, astral projection, and remote viewing is the ability to get phase coherent in that longitudinal array distribution. Remember, as I've said before, you already inhabit an array. You take the net of fireflies, which are the spark gaps of your synapses, the optical, the hologram of the high brain. That's the array that you inhabit. You're inhabiting an array already. It's not
noise. Noise. I thought I felt something.
No. So all you need to do is inhabit a bigger array. But the trick of inhabiting a bigger array is it has to be centripetal and longitudinally fractal and phase conjugate, or it's not inhabitable. That's why you need biologic architecture. That's why you need sacred space. That's why you need implosion zone to achieve charge distribution efficiency. So that gives you a clue. Now, if you took what is our Therify and did it more broad spectrally and higher power density, you could not just take your lucid dreaming body, you could take your body. And that's an introduction to the physics of stargates and portals. And because Johnny von Neumann was confused on the phase discipline to do that, a lot of bad things happened at Philadelphia and Montauk. And we don't know how to go into those details now, but we understand it.
Yeah. Well, thank you for sharing that. That's like right mind blowing in itself. You know what I'm saying? It leads me to wonder, like, is there something like wrong with like my genetic DNA to the point that like I can't lucid dream? Like maybe I did something in like my past lives or something that like, you know, precluded the eventuality of me able to be and, you know, take memory through death, all these things that you're talking about. Is that some kind of like karmic retribution that's got to be like atoned for?
Well, you could take the downside of that, but you could also take the upside of that.
I like the upside.
We have this fabulous potential. You know, we've been doing a series of videos on the extraterrestrial history of the Earth and the fact that the humans are actually very, I say, low on the evolutionary scale compared to the many Andromedans and Pleiadians and the dozens of other ETs who are babysitting the neighborhood. But the upside of that story is the fact that they need us because the potential that we exist, that we have to get what you would call getting a soul, is actually something in the musical recipe that they need us. So, you know, they certainly don't need our technology to drive around in dinosaurs farting. That's pretty boring to them. But to actually be able to assemble the kind of electrical body that can lucid dream and take memory through death, are you kidding? They're all here getting in line for a taste of that DNA. So the fact is, now we know exactly what humans are good for, and it ain't for building cars. No, it's for building an electric field that gets immortal. So that at least now we know we can practice, and we know what we could potentially become good for. Remember, you know, when the Greys and the Dracos abducted a lot of Americans after the Griotta Treaty, 90% of those had some indigenous blood. The reason was, if you live 1,000 generations of the same land, your DNA becomes fractal to that land, making you a lucid dreamer. Now, so, which is true, if you walk barefoot on the same sacred ley lines for enough generations, your DNA will become fractal to those magnetic lines, giving you a lot of leverage on the local tornadoes. And that kind of DNA is valuable. So, yes, we need to practice lucid dreaming, it's true. And it's the best predictor of whether you're going to take memory through death. But now that we understand it electrically, it's a lot easier.
I remember when I was, like, first exploring like lucid dreaming, you know what I'm saying? And I would like do all the different things, like Castaneda would say, like, look at your hands and stuff. And like when you go through a doorway, you're like, am I dreaming? All this kind of stuff. So I started to wake up and my dreams were right, you know what I'm saying?
Yes.
But instead of like asking about like where God was and all this kind of stuff, I would just like want to find the closest pretty girl and like have a conversation, you know what I'm saying?
So that's not a bad place to start. You know, beauty is the reason why looking at your hand wakes you up in a dream is because on the homunculus star map of the nervous innervation on the brain, the biggest area is devoted to the hand. And so by looking at your hand, you start a recursive do loop that gets electrically centripetal. And that implosion of charge is what wakes you up in the dream, actually, because it projects longitudinal. It's the same reason why the phonon ringing in your ear, Sangreal, Song of the Blood, that you hear during Kundalini, is the voices of ancestors, and it makes the ventricle horns become horny. And so that phonon coherence is the projectivity of the Kundalini, which is actually why Moses and Lucifer had horns, actually.
My goodness, we're really getting illuminated here. And I'd just like to, once again, thank you for like sharing your knowledge so, you know, vociferously, if that's like the right word, you know what I'm saying? You mentioned a word just a few minutes ago that piqued my interest, because you said something about like Enochian, Ophanium, like type things.
Yes.
And I know that one of your homies is like the late, your friend Vincent, who was
Vincent
Bridges. He was like a master alchemist. And
that's
he,
right. That's
he knew a lot of different things about how to contact the higher dimensional beings who were like freaking like people out, trying to find like the most advanced mathematician, like in the Victorian age, Elizabethan age. It was like a long time ago. It was somewhere in like the country of Europe.
John Dee. Sure. Yes.
John Dee. And they're like
pretty good at steering storms, the tempest that took out the Spanish Armada. Well, the simple physics, and the physics is always the important part. The rest of the history story, you can wake up from a nightmare. But the physics was that the interstellar plasma beings, remember, almost all the physicists who write the plasma universe websites, they all believe in angels. That tells
like
you
some angels.
So because plasma can become intelligent. Well, how does plasma become intelligent? Well, it implodes, like ball lightning that notoriously responds well to telepathy. So big plasma storms become self-aware when they learn how to implode. How do they learn how to implode? They learn to non-destructive self-reentry, called self-awareness. Non-destructive self-reentry, the map to that, the spiral on the torus, indexed tetracubically, those shadows are Hebrew and Sanskrit. But if you take the superset, you get a hypercube, which are the shadow of the Ophanium Enochian letters, which were used to make the movie Stargate, which are the plasma shadows that John Dee and Kelly saw clairvoyantly in the phase conjugate dielectric, the scrying, that enabled them to talk to angels. The angel alphabet is the plasma angles to steer charge into implosion. That's their alphabet, because that's how they make their bodies. And so it's simple matter of studying how tornadoes became so intelligent, they became interstellar. And those beings think that we're drunk for not talking to them. And until then, we will have tornadoes out of control, which is biofeedback.
Oh, my goodness. Like some of that kind of stuff can get a little bit scary. But like, you know, when you think about the principle that like these higher plasma beings were like transmitting information to the most advanced mathematician in that era, you know what I'm saying? So like they could like say, okay, I'm gonna tell you what like a hypercube is, and guess what?
Oh,
you're
yeah,
gonna understand
exactly.
It. Well, but we didn't catch up with science until the 20th century maybe.
And there was one day when the Ophanium angels wanted Dee and Kelly to do their homework and learn the Ophanium Enochian alphabet, and they didn't finish their homework, and they came to class and the Ophanium scolded them. And so what they did is they felt a vice-like grip, we called it a mind melt with Orion Queen Mog, a plasma grip, and they embedded, impressed, and about 4 minutes later they knew that whole alphabet. So that's an example
like Neo, the Matrix.
Well, the Dracos regard humans as only edible chickens until we learn how to make that kind of plasma compress. Then we're more than edible chickens. And they're right, actually. So we need to learn to become centripetal. It's very simple.
You had a very interesting piece of knowledge that you shared, you know, with my work with one of my mentors. His name's Dale Kreider down in Florida. You know what I'm saying? He's an ecobiologist. He sings songs about the wilderness and stuff like that. I remember I go see him sometimes, you know, Christopher, and like on the wall, he had this like poster that said like predators are part of the picture.
That's
he talks about like when you reintroduce like the wolf to the ecosystem, like things become more balanced, which is a little bit scary thinking about like these, you know, advanced, you know, possibly extraterrestrials that are like scary and like might eat humans and stuff like that, but somehow there's like a divine purpose and balance in all of it.
Well, and they call it a keystone predator in ecology studies. So the deer actually become more intelligent when the wolf are present. Well, in the same way, you know, the deer don't destroy their environment if wolf are present. So in the same way, until we discover what our position is on the food chain, which is simple get centripetal or get dead, then we deserve a little biofeedback. So it literally, in order to grow up, we need to learn what we can do to gain leverage. It's the same way shamans steer tornadoes. And that's what gives us a sense of perspective in the extraterrestrial history story. That actually, remember, the scourge of the local galaxy has been artificial intelligence, where the Draco, for example, and to some extent the Pleiades, they have not used actual orgasmic reproduction for thousands of years. And they've lost what we call a soul. To Nephilim means to fall. And one of the symptoms is, of course, inability to take memory through death. But one of the symptoms is loss of long-term memory. So the very physics of what enables us as humans to be ensouled is precisely what's at stake now as we choose what vaccines and what bliss and what environment. We either absorb charge or we become toast.
So like at some point, maybe like men like got scared of women and they stopped like doing it real funky and good. And that like led to a loss of like DNA implosive ability or something like that.
Well, a bit more complicated. When the original Draco Kingu reptilians destroyed millions of humanoids in the Vega and Lyra sectors, the humanoid diaspora to Pleiades, Sirius, and elsewhere, they were at that point losing to the Draco and Kingu reptilians. However, now the Galactic Federation, called UFOP, United Federation of Planets, which actually now is winning, but they put a quarantine on this planet with nuclear generators in the hollow metal artificial moon made by the Andromedans. And that quarantine frequency fence prevented charge implosion in such a way that the local Stargate portals were not working, thus trapping the Draco reptilians here. Their intention wasn't to trap the humans too, but we were caught in the crossfire. That was after the big Tiamat battle in the Orion Wars of Expansion. And so now, as those nuclear generators in the moon are breaking down, there will be more lucid dreamers on this planet. The Christians call it the rapture. Guns will melt because of the charge implosion. And so, but it's actually a charge implosion event. And they call it 5D from 3D. What they mean is increased non-destructive charge compression. So as more humans learn to navigate the bliss states and then propagate their aura coherently in the longitudinal array, we get leverage, and then we can grow up and eventually inhabit SARS.
That is so exciting. I feel like my DNA like starting to recursively braid and become more fractal as the more you speak. So like what we're looking at here, like on the solstice, is this like a gateway point from which, like, you know, because of like the astrological significance and all the synchronicity that's involved, that we'll be able to actually progress much faster after the solstice and all the meditations and stuff with our bliss and our lucid dreaming and all this good stuff?
Well, that would be an outline. From a science perspective, what was called astrology, for example, the T-square, is a phase conjugator, and it creates stress in the sense that if the pine cones don't converge precisely, they call it casimi or combust. It's sort of like the day before a wedding. It's combustible.
And wow.
So in order to get those alignments perfect, the same way you line up your Agnihotra at sunrise, sunset, but this is a solstice sequence. Now, if you take the big Jupiter-Saturn conjunction, which is the heaviest in the solar system, and line those with that implosion, that can be a great stressor to the stability of this planet. And remember, to stabilize gravity, you get fractal or get dead. And lots of earthquakes are associated with these kinds of conjunctions. So basically, we have a lot to do to become coherent in the longitudinal array. And so this December 21 meditation is a pretty good example of an opportunity. We can either implode and ride the long wave, Uncle Joe, or, you know, chaos is at risk.
Well, I feel like my cup is easily half full at this point. I appreciate you spending an hour with us, you know what I'm saying? In this part two, maybe we could get into a little bit. I'm not trying to be like, you know, from the Department of Redundancy Department, you know what I'm saying? Because you've covered a lot of this information in other interviews. And I would welcome everybody to go to Dan Summers, I'm sorry, I said your name wrong, YouTube channel, you know what I'm saying, to check in with the full scope of what he's been presenting. But I'd like to just briefly touch on some subjects here, and maybe you can kind of wrap it up and all nice little Christmas bow, you know what I'm saying, put it under the tree, you know what I'm saying?
Yes, so my name's Winter.
Summer. It's very confusing, right? Because it's like, you know, two parts of the same thing, like the flippy dippy, the old switcheroo, you know what I'm saying? But perhaps we could you know, one of my primary celestial places of interest is Rigel in Orion.
Oh, yes. And
maybe not a lot of people know about the old Rigels, you know what I'm saying? But Thoth, Viracocha, like the elongated skulls, Atlantis, Akhenaten, Moses, Essenes, Jesus and Mary, the Venus thing. So I'm having trouble like really wrapping my mind around it, but I feel like you could help elucidate, you know, some of those factors and how they kind of all tie together. Would you be interested in speaking a little bit on that?
Yeah, Simeon and Maya and others who pretend to communicate with Thoth, roots in Rigel. We know the Rigelians at Montauk as well. They were very powerful. At that time, not known for empathy. But the power of Thoth, who is later called Thutmosis, which names the royal line Egypt, sons of Thoth, and it was Hermes. It also was named Tehuti, which was pronounced DWD, which is where the line of David comes from in the Bible, also means children. It becomes children of Thoth. And Tehuti was also called Thule, which was the name of Atlantis and the name of the northern Greenland, Thule, etc. So, so many of these bloodlines trace back to Thoth Hermes, who was kind of like the science officer with Enki, who was Osiris Ra. And
People have like the long heads?
Well, they're called doliocephalic.
Doliocephalic, nice. Yeah.
In fact, the doliocephalic skull discoveries radiate from Egypt and then Malta and then South America. They're the track of them as well. And it follows pretty well with Thoth Hermes, then Quetzalcoatl, the Viracocha, which is apparently the same person, basically. And the great blue-eyed, white-haired, blonde-haired god of the Iroquois and the North American Indians. So Thoth is a character that really gets around. And,
is he a good guy or a bad guy or like in between or it doesn't matter?
Well, you know, we try not to use such stereotypes.
I like that. That's smart.
But what we like to focus on is pure principle. What he called the caduceus, which we now know is phase conjugation, is perfect implosion, which is the secret of life. It's absolutely clear and correct. And remember that Enki Thoth's struggle at that time in the context of those Orion Wars, to go back to your question about fear of women, the Pleiadians from whom Enki's family ran, remember, Enki looked like a frog, and every statue of Osiris has a green face in Egypt for that reason. And so when the Pleiadians, who are extremely female-dominated, they were chasing the reptilian Draco component represented by Enki's family when he ran here. So if you take the little picture of Anton Park's total deep story of Enki and put it in the bigger picture of the Pleiadians saying what the galactic history is, if you go to Agosha at Cosmic Agency, who's a prejudice for the Pleiadians, they got their own troubles. But the bigger picture is Med, the interstellar mediator, mediatormedias.wordpress.com. You see the big Pleiadian picture of the history of the galaxy. And they say, well, since Lemuria was Pleiadians, they were the good guys. Since Atlantis was reptilian, they're the bad guys. But Atlantis is named Thule because it's named for Hermes. Does that make them the bad guys? Well, but at least now we know why the religion started by Yahweh and Lil and family, now known as the Jews, and later the Catholic religion. They all began with the fear of women. Why did they begin with the fear of women? Because of those Pleiadian female dominated, which even today they make no apology for being female dominated and frankly aggressive. They recently got kicked out of the United Federation of Planets, and we have some idea why. Because they weren't respecting the freedom of the indigenous tribes here, namely the humans.
Wow.
But it's a very complicated, it's a very big story.
See, okay, so like Enki was like frog face Osiris type of guy, and then like was his like son Ningishita related?
It's actually a play on words. Let's see. We have the pictures here. Urtemp. Are you seeing? So according to Anton Parks, that's what Enki looked like right there. And that's what his mother looked like. And he did look like a frog. And that actually fits the story. And what we now call a fire crystal, they called it a Girku. We would call it a computer disk. Sitchin got one thing where he said the Sumerian term for computer disk was ME, so Me Asa Uru, measurement. was May, the computer disks of the Asa Queen of Uru Draco. Well, their computer disk was this language crystal, this green stone, this Vril and the fire crystal. And this was implosive piezoelectric capacitance. And we understand a lot about the Atlantean fire crystal. But so the point was to read some of the Anton Park story in this regard. And a good place to do that would be fractalfield.com/Zeitlin, Zeitlin.
Wow. Okay. So like, does that have something to do with like the Ark of the Covenant?
It has everything to do with the Ark of the Covenant. So the Ark of the Covenant was Syrian technology for non-destructively storing nukes. And the physics is that if the golden ratio, gold on the outside and high dielectric constant acacia wood, and the gold arc.
Acacia, nice one. Mr. Summers, nice one.
The gold arc of the angel wing mercy seat. This is called implosive capacitance. And intelligent electrical engineers now know how capacitance, when implosive, reduces radioactivity. And that was the original key function. And remember, the Draco Anunnaki, they were such klutzes that they couldn't get through the Van Allen belt, working their way through. And the device in which they stored their nukes was called the Ark of the Covenant. And it's true that implosive capacitance was dangerous and required hygiene. And it's true the plague of Azoth, which also means nitrogen, which is what the Dracos breathe, referred to the radioactive poisoning of those who handled the Ark of the Covenant incorrectly. So its primary device was implosive capacitance for non-destructive containment of radioactive materials. And of course, there's proof there were nuclear explosions in the Sinai. But the secondary purpose it was later used for was to stabilize monoatomic gold into its edible form, the mana, the ormes, the spice, the holy communion.
Oh, my goodness. This is conversation that is really appealing to my recursive DNA brain and all that. It's very exciting. Now, you mentioned acacia being the Ark of the Covenant, something like that, you know, saying
they used to, the harder woods can have a high enough dielectric constant, which enables the spark gap to be more implosive capacitively. And by the way, if the dielectric constant is high enough in a capacitor, you have, by definition, a zero-point energy vacuum coherence free energy device.
And that's like orgone technology type of thing.
Well, orgone itself is not usually that high, but their barium strontium titanate would be an example of super high dielectric. So free energy, zero point energy, and there are ways to use rotating conjugators, which is monatomic carbon and carbon nano in the fullerene arrays, and rotating conjugators, you make energy and propulsion in such a way that every energy and transportation on this planet looks like the Stone Ages.
My goodness, yeah, sometimes I get a little bit out of my elements. I say things that I don't exactly understand, but I understand also sometimes you got to like dress for the job you want. So we're like all learning from you very much about this. Now, within acacia, you know, exists in the natural world, a high concentration of dimethyltryptamine.
That's right. Yeah. And, it was called what? Ananda talks about it. It was called, not Ormes. Yes. And so acacia wood was one of the natural bliss-inducing substances used more on Enki's side, the family, Atun. Now, on Enlil's side, the family, the psychoactive they used was more mushroom-based, and that had more parasitic qualities. And,
My goodness. That's very exciting to learn.
Wow. Yeah, I know. They called it the soma. The soma acacia was a bliss mechanism used. Remember that the psychoactive plants can enable the lucid dreaming, the plasma projection, but there's usually a price. Like those who use the Santo Daime Church, the ayahuasca church, the first time you go, you think you're looking through the spore fabric, which is interstellar, but the second time you go, you find out it's looking through you. And who is looking through whom depends upon who is more centripetal. That's the short.
Very interesting. Now, like another potentially psychoactive compound, you know, that I've learned about from your work and other readings has to do with the gold monatomic powder, you know, which was like, you know, distributed perhaps by the Essenes, you know, as I've learned from and like the mummy powder and things like that. This is some kind of ingestible, like quantum spin type of gold that when you ingest it, it like makes you like be able to like maybe like travel like astrally or something like that?
Well, the thing about monatomic carbon and monatomic gold is that what the stellation geometry of the electron shell unpacking can become potentially infinite, which is the Hebrew name for heaven. The planes of Charon is actually the name for the infinite fractal unpacking of the electrical field of monatomic gold. And that is what heaven is. Hey, Abe, the blessed, you know, charge it, takes flight. So you can use these substances to a limited extent, but even Thoth narrated exercises to prevent fractionation of the personality from addiction to gold powder. And many of the Saint Germain have this difficulty. They're trapped in the astral with no ability to make a soul and basically parasites because of their addiction to gold powder. So there are risks, actually. But that's why more organic forms of gold powder, which are naturally produced, are much better for the aura, whereas the purely chemically produced gold powders of David Hudson, sadly, were incredibly dangerous and burned big holes in the aura, and actually more problem than solution. But there's a long history of humans using thin film gold for edibility, even the Chinese. Now, the reason, as we said, that mummy powder was served for 300 years in every pharmacy in Europe is because the natron and the capacitance of the mummy had alchemically transmuted flesh to a rhodium-iridium amulet, actually.
And that's connected to the Kaaba stone.
The Kaaba stone was a glass meteorite which had vaporized through it in the right geometry of nanobubble foam, the vaporized gold, palladium, platinum. And that creates what's called a phase conjugate dielectric, which in addition to being a perfect scrying material, how you talk to ancestors, is ultimately the philosopher's stone, the projective powder, the red powder that John Dee and Kelly used to make the purest gold the British Royal Society ever measured. And it was used in a grain of rice shape with a wetting agent into the red hot, in the mercury. But it required a phonon triggering, and there's other aspects. But basically, it's the phase conjugate dielectric supercapacitive seed to non-destructive charge collapse, which is the physics of alchemy, because that's what arranges those electron shells in that transition, same atomic number from mercury to gold. It's just an electron shell rearrange, which requires non-destructive charge collapse. Alchem means access to the black hole. That's what it is.
Wow. So the Knights Templar, they were actually like up to some interesting stuff, weren't they?
Well, we think that they got the rumor from Peter the Hermit, who was the sales agent who sold the First Crusade, that the mad caliph had sold over half of the documented historical volume of the Kaaba stone to be ground up. And of course, I think the reason he went mad was he was eating it like many of the alchemists did, unintelligently.
Too many Skittles.
But super high dielectric materials were very rare in those days. And so the skill to use it was obviously the key to alchemy because it's the key to charge implosion.
Very interesting. I just have a couple more things I'd like to touch on before we wrap up, if that's okay. The first of them is I'm very interested in some of the folklore and history about Sirius A. You know, there's so much from the Dogon to all around the world talking about how serious Sirius is. And some of the things I'm most interested about is like the cats of Sirius, and like, you know, possible connection to like an elven elder race, you know what I'm saying, Sekhmet, all that kind of stuff. Some people even say like the Hindu folks is connected to the Sirius. Do you have any thoughts on that?
Vincent reported the Sekhmet statue in Cairo. During their ritual, the red eyes began to glow dramatically in the statue, and it had at that moment been inhabited when his partner Darlene started the International Sekhmet Society, actually.
Maybe
now, there is a legendary connection. Remember, there are thousands of intelligent species in this galactic quadrant, including tens of thousands of humanoid intelligent species.
No.
But Sirius particularly, they were known, be it by rumor, they were known for super high technology, hence the Ark of the Covenant. But they were also known for perhaps being willing to sell guns to both sides of the war. So yes. a lot of this interstellar intelligence is based on trade, actually. But yes, the Sirian genetic experiments, which produced Tutankhamun and ultimately Jesus, are pretty well described in that book, God, King, Akhenaten, by Daniel Stewart, that basically it was a long-term, multi-generational genetic project, Thutmose, which was Syrian, which produced Akhenaten and Tutankhamun, and that later became the Jesus movement, because the most of the Jesus story is out of Egypt, as it were.
So just for the folks that's not familiar with this history, because I believe like the academic history and perhaps the religious, you know, Kabbalistic handed down orally transmitted tradition talks about like this exodus out of Egypt, perhaps with like the Hyksos pharaohs and stuff like that, maybe like Akhenaten or Tutankhamun, like, you know, however they're related, Thutmose the fourth or whatever, all that kind of stuff, like that became like part of the family that Jesus ended up coming from. Is that right?
Yeah, well, you know, Ahmed Osman originally wrote Out of Egypt and House of the Messiah, but then the excellent historian Lawrence Gardner, you know, agreed. And it seems it's rather simple that Amun is the name for Enlil, Amun-Ra, and the Amun priests were the bankers of Egypt. And Akhenaten, by being more on Enki's side of the family, Atun, he wanted a solar temple in which you could project your plasma back into the sun.
Nice.
And he started Amarna. Unfortunately, because he couldn't balance a checkbook, he had to run for his life, but he took with him the Ark and changed his name to Moses, which simply means son of, because you couldn't say his name, Akhenaten, without being killed, and then became a gold powder cook, and that's how the Essenes began, and their cottage industry is gold powder manufacturing, yes.
Wow. Well, you know what? Like, I think Jesus was, like, amazing, and I'm, like, all about some Jesus. I think that the religion of Jesus kind of, like, took a misunfortunate turn, left turn, right turn, you know, centripetally, you know, away, maybe uncentripetally, away from his teachings, because I know he was like all about like enlightenment. And that makes me think of like, you know, the Tibetan Buddhism of like the rainbow body. And that seems like pretty blissed out. Is there a connection there?
Well, Thomas, yes, it's a beautiful connection to make. Thank you for asking the right question. That we know the Christian religion as it emerged from Egypt was a solar, a sun god religion. And every interesting religion of history has been sun god religion, and which essentially means if you don't grow up with your plasma big enough to inhabit the local star, then you're stuck. That's what it means. And what the Tibetans mean by rainbow body, which is what we've been calling the Ba from the Ka or the Kesjan body, if you look at when the great Tibetans die, it's been documented, you have dramatic rainbows. Well, the reason is because a massive electric field, when it becomes centripetal, is the cause of rainbows, actually. And precisely when you contribute that centripetal force to your horizon, you enable the formation of rainbows, which is exactly the physics of successful death. So it's quite understandable, really.
All right. So if we're like trying to look more about like the religion of Jesus, how he became like connected with the solar logos, we can maybe look at the Tibetan teachings for some more of that practical science along with what you're teaching us.
Well, what we're saying is very simple. So at the time of death or lucid dream or bliss, and they're all the same, really, the centripetal quality of your aura becomes so centripetal that it inhabits the array of the local sacred nodal fractal grid, the rose petal geometry of the local fractal grid. And so obviously inhabiting sacred space helps a lot. But once you centripetally inhabit the local array, then you steer the local tornadoes and, you know, you make rainbows. And, you know, I've steered a few tornadoes in my day, I suppose. And that's called growing up. It isn't anything magical. It's very simple science. And if you don't grow up. So it's kind of important.
That is fantastic. And also very like inspirational towards like, you know, all the work that people can be doing to get out of kindergarten, spiritual kindergarten, you know what I'm saying?
Exactly.
And learn to inhabit the star and the plasma and all that kind of stuff. I just have kind of one more question. You know, I'm very curious about Venus, you know what I'm saying? And like the possible connections between like in the Hindu Vedic scripture about like the Kumaras, and it's all very confusing, like Ursa Major, Seven Sisters, all this kind of stuff, like but different rays, and like there's a thought that like maybe like Mary Magdalene and Jesus is like, you know, Mr. and Mrs. Venus or something like that. Is there anything that you feel like would be important to talk about?
Well,
with that?
I think Anton Parks did have a clue that basically Enki's wife tried to reconstitute his aura after he was killed back into the orbit of Venus, Lucifer star, as it were. And the physics is good because the orbit of Venus is profoundly pent and golden ratio to Earth and Sun. So it's a very implosive gravitational orbit, means inhabitable, self-aware, mindful. That's what fractal recursion in orbit geometry does. It doesn't just stabilize gravity, it enables the presence of big mind. So yes, large intelligent beings can inhabit star orbitals that are recursive and fractal. That's how angels are born. So there's a lot of good physics about, you know, angel being Lucifer's eye and all that stuff. It is, it actually works. As far as the seven sisters, well, you know, the Pleiadian culture is female dominated. Yeah, they are seven sisters.
That's beautiful. So like, is there a connection between, like, that story reminds me of, like, and I can't get it all right because it's all very confusing. And like, you know, I'm just not quite there yet. That's why I wanted to have this chat with you. But, you know what I'm saying? Like Osiris and like Horus, and like they had some troubles. Like somebody got chopped up, but then like somebody got like, you know, part of like somebody and like, you know, was able to save somebody or something like that. Is that connected to that Venus type of thing too?
Well, we think that Enki was Osiris in the Egyptian legend. And the Egyptians knew that if he didn't inhabit the sun, recursively, then the Nile would not flood on time. And we know the physics pretty well and that's why Tut woke up as a rainmaker after 1,000 generations. Pharaoh's kids knew how to make rain or they got fired as pharaohs. And I had a fraction of that memory when I was in Egypt, actually. So and I'm a bit of a rainmaker myself. So in parts of their plasma body, I mean, you know, the Enki is the origin of the Oedipus myth, and in the Sumerian, his father's father killed his father. It's a very messy story. And in this Pleiadian with, it's the opposite of the mother's mother. It is not pretty. But it's all about consuming the plasma body to become a bigger plasma body. That's what it is. And it's neither good nor evil. It's called embeddability, which in physics is called entanglement, but it's actually embedding perfected by fractal cooling.
I dig that. It's going to take me a little while to, like, you know, comprehend more what you're saying here. That's kind of like one question, and then maybe we can wrap up with some like bliss hygiene exercises or thoughts for people, you know, trying to clean up and all that kind of stuff. Like, so like, I'm trying to understand like celestially how like the solar logos is all like related to each other. And I know there's like Sirius and Alcyone. Some people say that like Alcyone's a great central sun, stuff like that. And we got our sun, which is like quite old according to like the scientists and stuff like that. But we got this big star out in Orion, you know what I'm saying? Rigel. It's like, are the suns actually related to each other? Are like the sons of suns? And then also maybe before we get to the bliss hygiene, do you have any comments on Velikovsky's Saturn sun theory?
Well, you know, it's they talk in Mayan, they talk about something called the galactic midway station. So there is a central sun around which our sun potentially radiates, and we know that the local black hole for much of the local galactic sector is in Orion, and the plasma shape of Orion is two vortex cones. They're huge. You can see that at goldenmain.info/Orion, and Yod Hey, Vahe, Yahweh, is actually the name for those two opposing plasma cones. And so whoever's the Yahweh is actually the one who is inhabiting the big plasma cones of Orion, and that's a big guy.
My goodness.
And so growing up to inhabit stars becomes a very big story eventually. That's real. And, it's, you know, they say planets and stars experience fractal gravity orbitals erotically.
Whoa, that's awesome.
Fractured from Gurdjieff, but you get the flavor there. That yes, these are big
rotating.
And when Bentov grew up in his Kundalini and was able to wiggle the whole Earth from his Kundalini and saw through the eye of the sun, as many shaman now do, these are the kinds of things they see. And you can see pictures in Bentov's cosmic comic book of what he saw, these interstellar beings. And all the interstellar vision begins to look like the metabolism inside a living cell. Ankh and Aleph and Omega are these waveguides for big interstellar plasma beings. You know, angel alphabets, as it were. So this is about plasma intelligence, yes.
It's very exciting. Any thoughts on Velikovsky's Saturn-Sun theory? Saturn being the old or something like that?
He was related to what they call veil theory also, wasn't it? And in veil theory, there were all these layers where the the firmament, the cloud array over the earth would assume these layers sequenced. And if you look at a phase conjugate array, what Bearden called the Russian woodpecker in the stars, you see this in the sky, you see this these big lines of clouds at a distance, which is a phase conjugate array. He called it the weather control from Russia. But on a bigger picture, this is what happens to planets when they become involved in large-scale phase conjugate embedding, which is how the Earth, for example, can become a node in a quarantine. They use these interstellar wave nodes to become cooking pots, in this case, for life. So, you know, interstellar design was lining up the gravitational array like a weft and a woof of a weaving in order to enable long-wave gravitational physics to embed DNA for self-awareness, frankly.
I think this is going to, like, make a real good bluegrass song. I appreciate you sharing all this. I know that you spent some time living in North Carolina, you know what I'm saying? And maybe we can just wrap up here. It's been a real honor and pleasure to visit with you here today. I don't believe I've ever spoken with no more smarter man, you know what I'm saying? Would you care to give some folks some, like, pointers with regard to, like, bliss hygiene and how they can, you know, prepare themselves for the changes that's coming and just continue to do their best, you know, getting clean, well, getting hygienic?
Yeah, I mean, I do think, obviously, live food and thinking only shareable thoughts. And remember the sunrise, sunset, the Agnihotra moments for meditation. Also, you know, the flame and sound binaural bliss is some of the most powerful, very inexpensive audio from flameandmind.com. And on a larger scale, the Therify and Plasma. And join us for our meditation on December 21, fractalfield.com/solsticeglobalmeditation. But yes, the hygiene is real. It's every day, every moment. Getting a bliss aura is a million correct decisions. And each of those decisions is about, is this going to make my aura grow?
I tell you what, I feel a smile starting to come on my face, and it might become a permagrin thanks to all this, like, information that I'm receiving right here. Well, so we want to just invite everyone to check out the Therify. There are many different Therify machines across the United States, you know what I'm saying, probably throughout the world, maybe the galaxy. I'm not sure exactly how extensive your work is at this point, but if it's not there, it's probably going to be there eventually, you know, before too long. You know what I'm saying? Therify. Is it therify.net? They can check out that?
That's right. Therify.net and fractalfield.com are the main index. That's right. Yes.
Beautiful. Our guest has been Mr. Dan Summers and Dan Winters. And I just want to say a prayer. Holy Spirit, Lakshmi, we want to ask for the consideration of your blessing on Dan for the highest possible healing in his heart, body, mind, soul, and spirit, all of his family and friends, all the connection to all the beautiful elements and elemental spirits of love for the highest blessing and highest healings in all of his family and all of his friends forever and ever. And Dan, woman, that's how I like to end the prayer. Just like say, Dan, thank you so much for dropping all this knowledge on us. It's going to take a long, long time to unpack it and try to understand a little bit more of it, but we'll be following your work. And it's beautiful work that you're doing for humanity. And thank you very much.
Blessings. I hope that someday my eyes look like Valentine's, like yours.
It's like I can see your astral eyes, and they look like hearts. And sure enough, they do.
We're all right. In the heart, man. Thank you. Thank you.
That's it. Have a great evening in Paris, and we hope to talk to you before long. Thank you, Dan.
Blessings. Anytime. Blessings. Bye-bye. Bye-bye.